What a great message. Thank you, Yuri. Thank you for that beautiful music. If you want to finish well, it helps to start out in the right direction. In October of 1964, October the 25th to be exact, the San Francisco 49ers were playing out in Old Kezar Stadium, and they were playing the Minnesota Vikings. And in those days, the Minnesota Vikings had a pretty formidable front defensive four. They were called the Purple People Eaters. And a defensive end on that team was a guy by the name of Jim Marshall, a great player. But on that day, on that fall day at Kezar Stadium in 1964, something really unusual happened. In fact, it had hardly happened before in an NFL football game. The Niners quarterback at that time, Y.A. Tittle, goes back to pass, and he throws a pass across the middle that is caught by Billy Kilmer. And if you're a Dallas Cowboys fan, you know that Billy Kilmer later became the quarterback for the Washington Redskins, and we all hated him. But on this day, Billy Kilmer is a receiver. He catches the ball, runs a few yards, gets hit. And when he's hit, he fumbles the ball and enters Jim Marshall. Jim Marshall picks up the ball and heads 66 yards the wrong way for a safety. Well, needless to say, he was embarrassed. His teammates were very understanding, and it turned out that Minnesota ended up winning the game, so that was okay. But afterwards, he was talking to reporters, and they said, how do you feel about it? And he said, well, I'm very embarrassed. And he said, I know that people will be talking about this for a long time. And Jim Marshall was right, because here we are 53 years later, and we're still talking about it. I want to talk to you this morning about finishing well. And maybe you're thinking, well, wait a minute, man, I'm just starting out. Well, that's all the more reason for us to talk about finishing and finishing well. And if you have a Bible, I want you to turn to Hebrews chapter 12. In a moment, we're going to read the first three verses. I want to talk to you about finishing well. The writer to Hebrews is writing to readers who are not going in the right direction. Instead of going forward with consistency and with strength and focus, it seems that they are regressing. The idea is that this letter was written to persecuted believers, Jewish Christians, perhaps, Dr. Allen, some priest. You know, we don't know. But we know that these readers were persecuted. They were suffering for their faith. They had experienced mistreatment far beyond what most of us in this room would ever begin to fathom or imagine. And so it seems that they're spiritually fatigued. They need encouragement. You may be thinking, well, oh, how do you know that? Well, let's look back in the text just for a moment. Look at chapter 2, verse 3. There is that warning, that strong word, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? And then you move ahead to chapter 3, verse 13, and there's a warning about the deceitfulness of sin. And you look ahead to chapter 5, verse 12, and the writer of Hebrews says, hey, by now you guys should already be teachers and leaders, but we're having to go back and build in the basic building blocks with you again. And we continue on in chapter 6. In chapter 6, the writer is saying, you've grown sluggish. You've grown sluggish. You were making progress, but now you've become spiritually fatigued. And then just to drive it home, jump ahead to chapter 10, verse 36, and what do you have? The writer there says, but you have need of endurance. But you have need of endurance. One of the most underestimated, unappreciated virtues in the Christian life is that aspect of endurance or perseverance. And we're going to see that word used at least three times in our text. That concept of endurance or enduring is used at least three times. Chapter 12, verse 1, chapter 12, verse 2, chapter 12, verse 3, three times, three verses. And you see it, as we've mentioned before, that concept of bearing up under a load, of staying focused, of staying in the race. Well, then we come to chapter 11, that great chapter on faith, and we have Faith's Hall of Fame. And all of that sets us up for what we have in chapter 12, in light of those who have gone before us, in light of the need to not grow discouraged, in light of the need to be aware that we can easily become spiritually fatigued, let us run with endurance the race set before us. So you follow along as I read our text, Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 3. This is the word of the Lord. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. This is a text that we need to hear this morning. I stand here this morning so grateful for this seminary that I love so much. I spent so much of my life here. I think about my days as a student in the MDiv program and later in the PhD program. And as I think about our text this morning, I think about those that I went to school with in this place, sat in classrooms with them, saw such great giftedness, such great intellectual ability, such a passion for the things of God. And now as I stand before you some 35 years later, the sad thing is a lot of those guys that I was in class with, they didn't finish. They didn't finish. It was D.L. Moody who said, the faith that fizzles at the finish had a fatal flaw from the first. How's that for some alliteration this morning? But you know, I think Moody was on to something. You see, the future for you and for all of us in this room, when it relates to finishing well, is a matter of our laser focus on none other than the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me tell you this morning, it's hard to sin. It is impossible, in fact, to sin and to engage in sin and to enjoy sin when I keep before my eyes the person and the work of Jesus Christ. When I think about who he is in all his glory, when I think about who he is as my sin substitute, as the one who became my atoning sacrifice, when that's the laser focus of my life, sin is deterred. And I'm telling you, this is what our text focuses on this morning. Now, I want to talk to you, as I said, about finishing well, but let me make a couple of disclaimers here. Different people mean different things by finishing well. You probably know some people, and for them, finishing well means gathering up a bunch of stuff. You know, I want to have a whole lot of things. I want to have a comfortable, cushy, easy retirement. I want security. For other people, finishing well means having a somewhat painless, easy death where they just kind of float out of this life into the next life. For others, finishing well means garnering all the accolades and praise and recognition and awards this world can offer. I want you to know I'm not talking about any of those things this morning. Well, Matthew, what are you talking about? Here's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about finishing well, and that means that the trajectory of your life is an ever upward growing conformity to the person of Jesus Christ. That's what it means to finish well. To finish well is to so live in the power of the Holy Spirit in such a way that the trajectory of my life is moving in growing conformity to Jesus because I am so obsessed with and occupied with all that God is for me in Jesus Christ. And that's what our passage is all about. Notice what we have. The author of Hebrews, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is writing to beleaguered Christians. They are discouraged. They've become sluggish. And you know what he does not do? He doesn't say, you know, let's have a psychology conference. Let's delve into your past. Let's talk about your hurt feelings and all the negative things that have happened in your past. And we just want you to get in touch with your feelings. He doesn't do that. The author of Hebrews doesn't say, get in touch with your feelings. He says, get in touch with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who has gone before you. Well, let's look at the text. There are, in our text this morning, three verses, just two imperatives. Two imperatives. Run with endurance, that's the first one. And the second imperative, you see it down in verse 3. Consider, consider. Weigh closely, look closely at it. Man, do we need to do that. Howard Hendricks, many years ago, did a study of at least 100 leaders in Scripture. And flowing out of that study, he discovered that almost two-thirds of leaders in the Bible did not finish well. So when we think about finishing well, God's Word has something to say to us today. Well, let's look at that first imperative. And you see it right there in verse 1. Let us run. It's interesting that so far in Hebrews, we have an expository focus, but things shift when we get to chapter 12. It becomes hortatory. It becomes urgent. There are these strong encouragements, and chapter 11 is connected to chapter 12 by that important word, therefore. Therefore, in view of those who've gone before us, who've lived their lives in the crucible of difficulty and hardship and persecution, who've lived lives of faithfulness, in view of that wonderful testimony, and in view of the fact that those Old Testament saints did not receive the full benefit of their salvation because God is doing something else, and He's going to gather us all through salvation in Jesus Christ, in view of these things, hey, run with endurance. Run with endurance. Now, I don't have to tell you that the race is a common metaphor for the Christian life. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul writes about running in such a way as to win the prize. Scholars think that perhaps at that point he had in mind the Isthmian Games, where in those games, runners would compete in a race and only one person got a prize. A lot of people ran the race, but only one person got the prize. And so in 1 Corinthians 9, Paul is saying, hey, run so as to win the race, to get first place. To win the prize. Now, we don't have any evidence that in first century Palestine, in first century life, there was such a thing as the marathon race, but I'm pretty sure here we're talking about more than a sprint. We're talking about a race that doesn't so much require a burst of initial speed, but a race that requires perseverance over the long haul. There are too many ministries that go up like a rocket and then come down like a rock. Hebrews chapter 12 helps us address that problem. Not a sprint, but a distance race requiring endurance. Now I want you to notice that word race. Let us run the race with endurance. That word race translates the word agon, from which we get our word agony. Paul will use it in some of his writings. We strive, we agonize the agony. And this passage blows up the idea that the Christian life involves just coasting. And I trusted Jesus to save me. And so now I'm just going to park it on the sideline and become a spectator in the Christian life. No, the Bible indicates that if we've called on the name of Jesus, we've been enrolled in the race of the Christian life. If you're here this morning and Jesus Christ has touched your life, you don't have a say in it. You're enrolled, you're enlisted, you're registered, you're in the race. You are in the race called the Christian life. And what does the Lord want us to do? He wants us to keep on running with endurance, bearing up under that load. Well, you know, preachers are really good sometimes at saying, hey, here's what you ought to do. You need to run the race with endurance. Run the race with endurance. And we say, amen, that's great, that's great. But then we don't talk about how that happens. I'm so glad the author of Hebrews, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, helps us out here. By what means do I run that race? By what means do I run this race called the Christian life? Well, I want you to notice that in our text, that basic imperative, run with endurance, is amplified, you might say, by three very important participial phrases. The first of these is right there at the first of verse 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, or having so great a cloud of witnesses. So how am I to run the race? I am to run the race being encouraged, being aware of those who have gone before me. As I said, the word therefore connects me back to chapter 11, the hall of faith, those people who were able to thrive in the crucible of persecution. And presently the text says, we have what? We have this cloud. The idea is a great host, a great gathered host of witnesses who've gone before us. Now, let me stop and address a very important matter. There's a lot of confusion when we get to this point in the text. You see, there are some who would say, oh, that cloud of witnesses has gone before us. Those Old Testament saints, you know, there's Moses and there's Elijah and there's the Old Testament saint, and they're gathered in the heavenly grandstands and they're cheering us on, and they've got that number one foam finger and they're just cheering us on to victory. And there's my beloved Aunt Susie and there's Grandpa Billy and there's all those people. Now, I got to tell you, that touches my heart. That's attractive to me. Here's the problem. That's not the primary focus of the text. The focus of this text is not those who've gone before us looking at us this morning. The focus of the text is those of us living in the here and now, running the race, looking to them and being inspired by their testimony. You say, well, where do you get that? Well, I look back at chapter 11, too. I look at chapter 11, verse 6. I look at chapter 11, verse 39. And what do I see? I see the writer stressing again and again that those who've gone before us have borne witness to a faith that endures. So if we're going to handle this text right, we've got to say, okay, that's a cool idea. They may be watching. They may be looking down on us. But the primary focus of this text is not them looking at us, but we look at them and we're inspired and we're encouraged by their faithfulness in running the race. Well, we need that inspiration. But you know, that's a problem sometimes, isn't it? We're all about inspiration. We like to hear great sermons. We go from conference to conference, filling up notebook after notebook, and we're all about inspiration, but we're short on application. But I love what the author does here. He quickly moves from inspiration to application. How do I run the race? By means of being aware of that cloud of witnesses that surrounds me and then laying aside. You could translate it, throwing off. Look at the text. Throwing off every weight and sin which clings so closely. Throwing off. Well, in ancient games, the runners, in many cases, showed up to the Colosseum or wherever the race was, and they showed up and they had their long flowing robes on. But when it came time for the race, guess what? All those robes came off. They stripped down, in many cases, completely down, okay? Those runners did not want to have anything impeding their progress. We see this imagery in the Bible, girding up your loins, okay? It's the idea of, I'm not going to let anything get in the way of my objective. And my objective is to get across the finish line and to finish the race. I don't want to be tripped up by anything. So look at the text. Let us lay aside every encumbrance and sin. What is the sin being referred to? Well, if we pay attention to the context, the sin that the author of Hebrews is addressing here is specifically the sin of what we might call sluggishness. Sluggishness. These people have gotten spiritually fatigued. They've become complacent. It's as if they have adopted a mindset that says, well, there's nothing of real significance at stake. We'll just go through the motions. And the end result is a Holy Spirit quenching perspective that is nothing more than a check the box, I fulfill my duty. What a sad way to live the Christian life. And so the author says, laying aside every encumbrance. You know, so often we ask the wrong questions. We ask questions like, well, I want to love Jesus and I want to honor Jesus, but I wonder if this is allowed. I wonder if this is allowed. Would this be allowable? That's not the question we should ask. You see, our ultimate problem, at least for most of us, we understand what the Bible clearly prohibits, and certainly we should avoid what the Bible clearly prohibits. But too often we fail to ask this question, the one we should ask. Not whether something is allowable, whether it might be tolerated. The question we ought to ask is, will this help me run the race? Will this help me love Jesus more? Will this make me more like Jesus? Will this cause me to have greater passion and devotion to Jesus? That's what the author of Hebrews is getting at. But the problem this morning is that too often it's true of all of us. We have too much debris in our lives. It's not a matter of getting rid of the bad things only. It's making sure we don't let the tolerable things, the so-called good things, crowd out the better things to such an extent that there's so much debris in our lives that it's like we're living the Christian life in a set of concrete boots. A couple of weeks ago in the Dallas Morning News, Jacob Bachman wrote an interesting article for Bloomberg News. The title caught my attention. It made me think about our text. Listen to this. Orbiting junkyard begins to threaten space economy. And then Bachman writes these words, the space surrounding our pale blue dot, our home, is quickly becoming a cosmic junkyard. Debris abounds, moving at ludicrous speeds and presenting plenty of hassles for satellite operators who do business in orbit. Debris in low Earth orbit travels up to 5 miles per second, 18,000 miles an hour, which gives the tiniest junk enormous destructive energy. You know, I read that article and I thought, wow, there's all this junk orbiting around, and so often we're not aware of it and its destructive implications. I think you can see the connection. I wonder what junk is orbiting in the Milky Way of your ministry this morning that's cluttering up your walk with Christ that you don't see as dangerous and destructive now. But if you allow it to go on and you allow it to build and to develop, your spiritual life will look like the worst case that you've ever seen physically on television of hoarders. You know those houses? You know the guy, he can't even walk in his own house. He has to cut a path through all the newspapers and all the detritus and all the stuff there. That's what the writer is saying here. I heard a pastor tell the story of being overseas, and he was visiting with some medical missionaries who flew medical supplies into very hard-to-get places, and they had a new airplane. They wanted him to take a look at the new airplane and see some of the supplies, and so he goes out to the hangar, and he sees from the outside this beautiful new airplane, and they want him to take a look inside, and when he looks inside, he's stunned. Instead of seeing plush cushioned seats and walnut paneled walls, he saw none of that. The chairs looked like folding metal chairs where the pilot sat, and no cushioned seats or fancy controls, just stripped down, bare. In the compartment where people could sit, or where there was space for supplies. I mean, instead of beautiful cushioned seats, again, stripped down. And so he said, what's going on here? And they said, look, our objective is to get the maximum amount of medical supplies on every flight so that we can reach our objective of helping the most people possible. Therefore, we strip down anything that doesn't contribute to that purpose. Throwing off every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us. Well, how do I run the race with endurance? Well, I'm encouraged by those who've gone before me. I want to throw off those things, strip down, so that I'm lean and mean. I've lost my luggage. I'm ready to follow Jesus fully. And then the third thing, and the most important thing, look at it. Looking to Jesus. You see, in the Christian life, it's too easy for me to say, you know what? I'm doing all right. I think I'm just going to put her on cruise control for a while. I'm just going to coast a little bit here. And if I don't do that, the next thing that the tempter will tempt me to do is to compare myself with everybody else. You know, just say, well, you know, I may not have made as much progress as other people, but I'm certainly doing a whole lot better than that guy down the street. Or look at that guy over there. But you know what? The Bible never calls you to coast, and the Bible never calls you to compare. The Bible calls you to concentrate on the person of Jesus. I know I may sound old-fashioned. It may sound impractical, but you know what? I don't think you can improve on what the biblical author prescribes here. How do I run the race of the Christian life? With a laser focus on Jesus. I think about Jesus. I read about Jesus. I learn about Jesus. I love Jesus. That's the focus. And you see, our problem is we think, oh, yeah, oh, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. You need that when you're first saved. Listen to me. You need to love Jesus and be in an ongoing love relationship with him every bit as much as when you've been a Christian 15 years, 25 years, 50 years, as the day he saved you. Amen. Looking to Jesus. It's a laser focus. And what do we see about Jesus? Look at the description there quickly. He's called the founder. You could translate it champion. Isn't that beautiful? He's the champion. He's the pioneer. He's the trailblazer. In chapter 6, verse 20, he's the forerunner. He clears the path. He's the founder, and then he's the perfecter. He completes. So I put all that together, and what do I see? Jesus is the object. He's the source. And he's the substance of my faith. Here's how I'd say it. According to the author of Hebrews, according to Holy Scripture, Jesus isn't something, Jesus is everything. And that's our problem. Too often, he's a segment of my life when he should be the sovereign of my life. He's a contributor to my life when he ought to be the blazing center of my life. Looking to Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. And man, would you look at the rest of the text, who for the joy set before him. Man, there's a sermon in that. Too often we get so focused on the trial we're going through. We've never had a trial like the trial that Jesus had, but you know what we learn from him? Jesus focuses not so much on what he's going through as he focuses on where he's going to. Who for the joy set before him. What was the joy? The joy of being obedient to the Father's will. The joy of in obedience to the Father, becoming a substitutionary sacrifice, an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Only mentioned specifically, overtly, of the cross in all of the book of Hebrews right here. Pretty important. Who endured, who bore up under the load of the cross, despising the shame. I always wondered what that meant. And the idea is that Jesus disdained. He didn't like the inhumane, the grotesque, cruel, criminal's treatment he received. But he despised it. He disdained it by not allowing the shame or the suffering to deter him from his mission. And that was to be obedient to the Father and to pay the price for the sins of the whole world. And let me tell you this morning, that's the only reason you and I even have the possibility of taking another step in the race of the Christian life. Some of you are runners here, and I've heard runners talk about hitting that wall at mile 11 or mile 12 in the marathon, and man, you feel like your limbs are about to fall off, and it's like those old Star Trek episodes, must have air, your lungs are about to explode. What do you do on those days when you think, I don't know if I can take another step? My heart's so broken. My burden is so heavy. My challenges are so many. I don't know what to do. What do you do? You look to Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and oh, it gets better, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father. That's a perfect tense in your Greek New Testament. I love it. It speaks of permanence. You see, Jesus is never going to have to come and sacrifice himself and become a blood atonement again. He's never going to do that again. It's a permanent sacrifice, and as a result, he is permanently enthroned. He's permanently exalted, and from his throne, he hears the cries of every one of us as we run the race of the Christian life and cry out to him. He promised to be my intercessor. He promised to be my advocate. How do I endure? I look to Jesus. He sat down. I love that. It's finished. That's what the author is driving home. It's done. He sat down. He has sat down. It's done. It's finished. He sat down. And one day he'll return again in power and glory. But until then, he hears the cry of his children. Brings to mind the most oft-quoted Old Testament text in the New. The Father speaks to the Son. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Man, what a great reminder. I don't care how crazy this world is. God has ordained. God has planned it. God's going to carry it out. He's going to sum up everything under the headship and lordship of Jesus Christ. And every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That's the good news. And we run the race looking to him, the author and finisher of our faith. Now look at verse 3, the second imperative. Consider him. The word means carefully reflect. Look at it from every angle. Carefully reflect. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility. We can't imagine. We can't fathom such hostility. So that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. The exact opposite of enduring. Don't want you to grow weary or faint-hearted. Listen to me this morning. If you've never been weary or faint-hearted, those days are coming. And here's a passage of scripture that the Holy Spirit will use to lift you up and to carry you through the next phase of life that God has for you. And listen to me, this is important. We do not run in order to earn salvation. We run because we've been saved and we have the Spirit of Christ living in us. John Newton had it right. His great grace hath brought us safe thus far. And what? And grace will lead us home. Home. And grace will lead us home. I like what Mickey Spillane said. He said, the most important part of a story is its ending. No one reads a book to get to the middle. Isn't that right? I mean, think about it. You look at a box of Wheaties, there aren't boxes of Wheaties that have a person on that box and it says, congratulations, we're celebrating this guy on Wheaties because he got off to a good start. No. There are no boxes of Wheaties that have a picture of a guy that says, hey, congratulations to this guy. At the halfway point, he was in first place. No, that's not it. We celebrate those who got across the finish line. Well, I think one of the most stirring things in athletic history I've ever seen happened in 1992 at the Barcelona Games to a British 400-meter specialist by the name of Derek Redmond. Maybe you've seen the video. Derek Redmond was not able to run in the Seoul Olympics in 1988 because he had a series of problems with his Achilles. He had as many as 8 surgeries. And so when he got to the Olympics in 1992, for the first time in many years, he was healthy. And I mean, he powered through the early preliminaries of the 400 meters and he made it to the semifinal. He was feeling great. He was looking great. He takes off in a blaze in that race, but he gets to the backstretch and to hear him tell it, he felt like he'd been shot. It's like he heard a shot go off. His hamstring snapped and he fell to the ground writhing in pain. But then Derek Redmond did something unusual. He got up. And slowly, he got back in his lane and began to limp toward the finish line. But then something even crazier happened. You can see the video, and down through the stands, you see a commotion, and you see this big giant of a man pushing security guards away. It's Derek's father, Jim Redmond. Jim Redmond goes to his son and embraces him in a bear hug, and then it gets more bizarre. Derek Redmond drapes his arms around his father. Father embraces son, and together they cross the finish line. And this is what, in an interview, Jim Redmond said afterwards. I intended to go over the line with him. We started his career together. I thought we should finish it together. And I got to tell you, that's a great story. It grips my heart. But let me do something this morning. In preaching class, we call it moving Dr. Allen from the lesser to the greater. Let's go lesser to greater. That's a great story, isn't it? That doesn't hold a candle to what God in Jesus Christ has done for you and me. He spared not his one and only son, but freely gave him up, self, gave himself up for us all. You see, you've never taken a step in the Christian life that Jesus didn't take before you. And guess what? He goes ahead of you. You're never going to take a step where he's not already ahead of you. And when you get to the finish line, guess who will meet you there? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, saying, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy that is prepared for you." How do I finish well? I focus on the endurance of Jesus and let it fuel my own endurance in the race of life. God help us finish well.